future trends, deep insights, industry leaders. This is the iGaming Next podcast with your host, Pierre Lindh.
All right, Disa Stigh, how's it going?
Everything is perfectly fine. How are you doing, Pierre?
I'm very well, thank you, Disa. This is the third time's a charm to start this podcast. And not only that, but we've been trying to get a date to do this podcast for a long time. There's been back and forth, but now we are live, we are here, and now we go. How's it going? How's the Easter so far?
So far, it's going well. I just finished off baking a beautiful cake that I'm going to serve tomorrow. So off to a good start with the Easter.
Amazing.
And thank you so much for finally having me here on the podcast as well.
Yes, it's an absolute pleasure, Disa. Like you said, this is the second take of this podcast. We had a little software issue here before, but we were saying before that we've been knowing each other. We've known each other for quite some time in general, and obviously been following each other through the years here in Malta. But there's also another reason that kind of we're here today, and something else that kind of the reason that we know each other, which is the fact that obviously we both started our podcast at the beginning of this pandemic. And I'd love for you to kind of start off by kind of introducing yourself and kind of what your podcast is about a little bit. So feel free.
Yeah, sure. So my name is Disa Stigh. I'm a 25-year-old Swedish girl, living in Malta for 7 years. I always say 6-7 years because I can't keep track on time anymore. And I've, as you said, I launched my podcast or my YouTube concept more or less during the start of the pandemic. And it's called Casino by Her. And I purely wanted to focus on highlighting iGaming profiles and not really focusing on, business strategies or going very hardcore on the pure business that they're representing, but more of who they are, to give different people a different, approach and some time online to really tell who they are in this industry. So that is the core of Casino by Her highlight.
That's awesome. And I've been following this podcast as well now, obviously, since the pandemic started. And I'm a big podcast fan myself, and I really appreciate the kind of you're bringing these figures to light, because it's not always the most high profile people, let's say, that you bring to light. But I think if there's anything that this pandemic has brought out in a positive light from the iGaming industry, is the fact that like you and others are giving this really great platform to highlight the talent that we have within this industry. And I wanted to ask you, what have you kind of learned through the episodes that you've done so far, and can you talk a little bit about the guests that you've had on and so on and so forth?
Yeah, sure. So I'm gonna start off by saying that one thing that I recognize that everyone has in common, besides that they did not believe they were gonna end up in iGaming from the first place, they all say that they wished that someone were there for them in the beginning, to tell them, how they're going to proceed, what it's all about. And there was so limited resources and help to get in the beginning to, for them to take their career to the next level. So that is really beautiful for me to have this, to release this podcast series or episodes so they can be that person for someone else. That is something that I realized really quickly, that everybody felt that they didn't have someone support them throughout their career.
And that's fantastic, and even I would assume even for you as a host, and an aspiring professional as you are as well, having these people on and picking their brain and learning from them, I'm just the same for my own kind of adventure here throughout the episodes that I've done through the podcast. It's been an absolute revolution for me in my personal journey to be able to sit with these people and just pick their brains, right? Like, that's also something that must be fantastic for you as well, I would imagine.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I interviewed a man called Henny Blau. I mean, we were never in the same circles. I know he's from, he used to work for Yggdrasil for many years, gaming supplier background, a super talented man, very humble. I loved to do the interview with him. And I mean, I didn't know anything really about how game production from, you know, from an idea to the actual finished game on any of the operators' sites. So he guided me through that whole process. And Chloe Borch, another beautiful, talented woman, she used to be actually my coach or my trainer at Evolution Gaming way back in time. So we exchanged a lot of, you know, information and career advices and so on. So it's been very rewarding to speak to these people.
Yeah, that's awesome. And you know, talking about Evolution in general, you know, something that fascinates me about you, Disa, you know, at the tender age of 25, I mean, you've gone from being a live dealer just a couple of years ago to CCO of a respected company, Net Value Media. And this to me signifies what is so amazing with the iGaming industry, because I think that most people who enter this industry tend to enter it from a quite junior position. And even the people you see in the C-level positions have started from fairly junior positions and kind of worked their way up. It's kind of like you have to walk through the fire a bit in this industry to get somewhere. Some people manage it, some people don't, and some people are happy where they are, you know? And that's totally okay. But can you talk about your journey, you know, as a, starting as live dealer, and how did you end up working your way up to CCO of a respected organization? What's the secret here?
Oh God, it's secret. Dedication.
Yeah.
No, but I mean, when I came to Malta, I had no idea what iGaming was. I was not familiar with anything related to gaming or casino whatsoever. And I got this job as a live dealer for Evolution Gaming. And I didn't even apply for the job at the beginning. I don't know if I told you the story even.
No, tell me, please.
So I was here on vacation, right? And the ex-boyfriend of mine, he really felt like, okay, let's get out of Sweden. We need to, you know, something needs to happen in our life. We need to do something. So we were here on vacation and he found this job. They were seeking live dealers at Evolution Gaming. So he applied behind my back and...
Hence why he's the ex-boyfriend, maybe.
Exactly. Yeah. Goodbye. No, joke aside. But... Yeah. But so they called me and I was sipping my, I don't know, pina colada. I was staying in Valletta at Excelsior by the time. And Sarah called me and said, hi, you know, I love your resume and I think that you'll be a great fit. Can you come for an interview? I was like, what are you talking about? What interview? I mean, no, I think you must call the wrong person. I never applied for a job. It's like, yeah, but I have your application here. And I felt so bad, because I didn't know what she was talking about. So I just felt like I have to go to this interview. No matter what, regardless if I want a job or, you know, what I'm going to speak about, etc. So I went and they called me the same afternoon and asked me if I wanted a job. So that's how I started. Oh, wow. I just went back, got my bags, came back to Malta and started my job as a live dealer.
So this happened from one day to the other, literally?
Yeah, the same afternoon. And I mean, it was crazy. I remember I called my parents and I said, you know what, I'm going to move to Malta. I'm going to take this job. And they're like, are you crazy? Like, yes. What are you talking about? This is nuts. But so that's how I started as a live dealer. And I kept doing that for a while and realized that it was not so unfamiliar with what I have been doing in the past, you know, dealing with people. I come from a restaurant industry. Used to do a lot of PR, marketing, sales. So I could find some similarities in that role when I worked for Evolution Gaming as a live dealer, representing various operators online. So it was kind of a natural step, even though it was a completely different industry. And after a while, I wanted to evolve and decided to let's be a daredevil here and see if I can get a chance as an affiliate manager, which was, as you say, like a huge step. Just from live dealer to affiliate manager. got denied a few jobs. I went for an interview with Tobias Regnestam, for example.
Yes, Tobias, shout out.
Yeah.
Yeah, our old friend.
I don't know if you remember this interview, but I do. It wasn't one of my best moments, for sure.
No,
not really. But eventually I landed a job as an affiliate manager. And from then it just really took off. So from live dealer to affiliate manager, then I got the chance to be part of a startup as head of affiliates, head of acquisition. And then Fredrik Javidi, who's running Netvilly Media with me, reached out and said that he'd been following my journey for some time and asked me if I wanted to join as their CCO.
How was that to get the offer as to start as CCO for that organization? I mean, it's a big step up.
Yeah, sure. I mean, to be honest, I believe that every step I've been taking so far has been like the most scariest part of my life. But when he asked me, I just said that I have nothing to lose, right? I already kind of proven myself over the years that I've been able to take big steps. Have a lot to learn still, but I feel comfortable, and I believe at the end of the day, if you just work hard, you're going to be able to manage to sort any problems on the way. And if you don't, okay, then you don't. And it's not the end of the world.
Yeah, exactly. I think that's a brilliant mindset in general. So Disa, how long did it take for you to accept that position with Sara at Evolution until you got this position as at Netvalue Media?
So that would be, I would say, 5.5 years in between. Yeah.
Yeah, it's incredible. I mean, you know, it seems to me that you know, you come across as a very strong, confident person in general, you know, and there are some people who gets frightened by the prospect of taking this big step up, so they kind of they don't do it. Maybe they feel comfortable in their position and they end up staying there maybe longer than they should if they are talented and they want to move on, and then there are some people who just faces these challenges head on, you know. Would you say that? Does it come down to just like mental toughness? I mean, you're a fighter as well. You know, you do difficult things. Is this like part of like an excitement that you have to just like do difficult things? Or you must be nervous stepping into Netmanivia the first day. I mean,
of course. I mean, I don't want to come across as like I'm this super hardcore woman who's never frightened or never terrified or... I mean, there's so many days where I'm feeling like, what the hell am I doing? Sorry for cursing in the podcast, but you know, that would be a lie. It took me a really long time to, first of all, move along from like that, even dare to apply for affiliate manager. Because I was just constantly looking at, I need to do something else. I feel like I have the aspirations to do something else, the ambition, the knowledge. But when you start looking at the, you know, who do they search for? What are they looking for? You don't tick all the boxes. And you will never do that, most probably. But if you tick off, let's say, the majority of the boxes, there is no reason not to try. But it took me a really long time to do that. And once I took the first step and I gained some confidence, I believe that you're just going to go with it. It's just to take that first step, then you're going to feel like you're fine, that you're going to get some leverage and confidence.
Yeah, exactly. Because, I mean, there would be a lot of other live dealers in your situation there, for example, at Evolution Gaming, who could also apply for positions like affiliate managers, you know, and maybe sometimes a lot of people, they underestimate their own capabilities. So they would be a live dealer and they would say, oh, you know, I'm not suited for being an affiliate manager, or people in that position, they have more experience than me, or there's more people that are better suited than me. So therefore, maybe they don't end up applying. But in your case, you know, you knew that you didn't have that experience. You knew that you didn't have like a similar experience in your resume or whatnot. But still, you decided like, yeah, let's give it a go. Because in the end of the day, what do you have to lose, right?
Yeah, sure. And I think that the longer you work within iGaming, you really realize that this is very, for like, you know, forgiving industry. You don't need to have years and years at university. I mean, you can work your way up. I mean, there's really no other industry, especially not in Sweden, where we come from, where we can do that. And you realize that also the people that you speak so highly about, or that you already put on a pedestal, they don't even tick all those boxes. And they still ended up having that job that you maybe want to have one day. So you just need to calm down and look at, what am I great at? What is my strengths here? And what can I actually offer? And why shouldn't they want those great skills at their company?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, and I mean, you have a lot better confidence than what I had, for example, when I was going through that part of my career. I mean, I was a VIP manager at Betsson when I moved to Malta like 10 years ago, and I used to look at my managers and the C-suite and the top managers in the company as like, these people have something that I don't. They are like special in some way. There's something they are tapped into, and you know, they started reading about how to become a CEO when they were 6 years old, and they were always meant to be that or whatever. That's how my mind was working at that time, and I think a lot of people are walking around with that mindset. But the biggest learning I had in my career, I think, is that when I started eventually working with C-levels, or I started to have meetings with them and so on and so forth, you realize that there is nothing special with them. I mean, with all due respect, but there is nothing special with most C-levels, and that type of position is very attainable if you just put your mind to it, right?
Yeah, and I think you said something really interesting there. When you come across that, there's nothing special with them. I mean, let's say that I'm a C-level now. I have friends that are not on a C-level. They don't look at me in a different manner, right? Because they know me. So I think that we need to stop putting people on pedestals and living this fantasy world where we give them the authority to be that powerful in a scary way.
Exactly.
Because, yeah.
Yeah, and then you can look at it like reversing the roles as well. I think, you know, I'm close friends with some C-levels these days. And we talk a lot about this, you know, how did you end up in this position? A lot of people are walking around with imposter syndrome. A lot of people, most people, I think, in that, where they basically are questioning themselves and convincing themselves that, you know, I shouldn't be here. You know, like I'm not competent enough to be in this position. There's a lot of insecurities, you know, that they are walking around with, you know, that can lead sometimes to like bad trades in managers, where they feel insecure and they don't want to promote the people below them that they see talented, for example. But I think that's more that's not so common. But more common is just the fact that like most C-levels that you look at, and they look very confident from the outside. In reality, they are walking around questioning themselves or not sure if like what made me into this position and whatnot. And that just solidifies this fact to me that the step from, you know, from being an affiliate manager to actually becoming a C-level is not that big of a step as most people might think.
No, I mean, obviously, I mean, it takes years to gain knowledge and network. Network is key. It is not that big of a step. If that is something you want, and if you want to be, I mean, if you want to manage other people as well on a C-level, you just bring all this positivity, knowing that, okay, so this manager didn't treat me right. This CEO were not the best at this company. How can I change that? Who do I want to be for my employees? And there's your strength when you move up and managing a team or a company.
Exactly, you know, and you know, if you are a talented individual, which you clearly are as well, Disa, when you get yourself a couple of wins in an organization, you know, in your case, as the live dealer revolution. You know, I remember clearly when you took the prize at the iGaming Idol as the live dealer of the year. You know, that's a win. You know, and then all of a sudden you're like, wow, like I can do great here. And then you have a couple of other wins, and you really build up that confidence to just learn that you can do anything. Can you talk a little bit about like iGaming Idol in general, your experience there when you won that prize?
Yeah, of course. So we can start by saying, you know, when we knew this iGaming Idol was going to happening, you know, the whole company was going mad, like, okay, now we need to perform super good. And, you know, we had all eyes on you, and it was, you know, a talk of the town, so to speak, at the company. And when I got two of my managers nominated me for iGaming Idol, and I received a notification email, you know, just a text that they sent in. And I was so flattered just knowing that, you know, I didn't come from iGaming. I just worked there for a year or something. And it was like a, you know, stamp that, okay, I've been doing something good for this company. And during the whole process with the, you know, being in front of the jury and then ending up winning the first edition of iGaming Idol gave me a huge confidence boost. Because I believe that I achieved something. I came from nothing. And then I became someone over, you know, over the night, or that was my night. So that was a great, really great experience. And I really believe until today that was a huge part of why I landed a job as affiliate manager, because they, you know, someone kind of vouched for me. Okay, so she won this. It's got to be something, you know, she can probably contribute with something, even though she doesn't have this and this experience. But if the industry recognizing this person on Malta to be someone, probably we should give her a chance.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know, I think that's a big part of why we put that show on in the first place as well, is the fact that we are able to kind of recognize the talent in the industry, but also to aspire people to feel that they can work towards something like a recognition like that. Because I'm sure that like your colleagues see you winning and they are like, they want to kind of increase the level to be able to do the same, you know?
Yeah.
And I think another great example was like the year after, there was Lassan Mersug, who won iGaming Idol as well as the he won the manager of the year at that time. And he started as affiliate manager as well in the industry. And he went from affiliate manager I can't remember the company, Redbet, to becoming the CEO of Come On Group, which was at that time valued at like €1 billion in 6 years. Well, I mean, it's incredible, right? I mean, I don't want to like repeat myself too much in it, but I love the industry for that reason. And it's not that lesson that there's like a lack of talent in industry or whatever. Like, yeah, you obviously very talented, a hardworking person.
Thank you.
So is Lassan, you know, one of my best friends. And when he became the CEO, I was like, you know, even though he doesn't have the experience perhaps, but there are some people who will go into these positions and they'll just figure it out. You know, they'll work hard, they are committed, and they'll figure it out. And if you have that mindset, you're always going to be successful, I think.
But I think we also need to think about how the industry are built in this way. I mean, as we said, if you apply for a job in Sweden, for example, they're going to look at your resume and say, okay, so you have a lack of this and this time at uni, or you know, they're going to look at flaws rather than see the person. The people who built the iGaming industry in Malta are proper doers, you know, who came from, they didn't have the experience when they wanted to set up the first casinos or the gaming suppliers or anything in Malta. They built everything from scratch. So they know that anything is possible. And I think that kind of mindset with these leaders from the beginning have kind of inspired them to be better for the people that they hire, and also recognize that, okay, I see this as a talent. I know that that person don't have this, this, and this, but I'm pretty sure this person will be a great fit in the future. So I think we have to thank a lot of beautiful men and women out there as well for setting this up for us.
Exactly. We're standing on the shoulders of giants, right? That's the thing. Like we often talk about in our organization that there's been in the legacy of the iGaming industry is not always the prettiest as well. We come with a baggage of problems as well, but we still have to recognize the Pontus Lindwalls of this world and the others who set up Net and Betsson of these organizations that allowed us then to kind of go on our own little journeys in this industry. And, you know, this is close to thought on this as well is, compare the iGaming industry to we are a young dynamic industry as well, because we have to figure things out. You know, I mean, there's no track record for the last 150 years. You know, how do you build a successful operator? Because the landscape is constantly changing in the industry, right? And we have to change with it. So there is no manual on how to study to become a great CEO of an iGaming operator. It has to come from experience, right? And if you look, like, compare it to like the banking industry or whatever, you know, you wouldn't go from the from like the bank teller in the shop, whatever, to become the CEO of the bank in 6 years. You know, that's a legacy industry, which is very conservative. And, you have to accumulate this, how do you work within, how do you become a cog in a wheel in this like big, in this big machine to like fit into this organization that run the same way as it's run forever. And it's not gonna change. And you are not there to change. You're just there to maintain, kind of thing.
Yeah,
and that's what's beautiful in the industry.
No, you're completely right, and that's what makes our industry so amazing, as you said,
yes.
And innovative.
Yes, what a love story it is today, I must say. Yeah. Right, we're proclaiming our love for the iGaming industry.
Yeah, so much love.
yes, exactly. iGaming industry.
Yeah.
Anyway, so Disa, I wanted to also just go into to the fact that speaking about mindset and being a strong person and these other things, you're also a fighter in all this, which I'm just very fascinated by as well. Can you talk a little bit more about this? You were supposed to have a fight like pretty much now, more or less, but obviously due to COVID it was postponed. Talk a little bit about like your mentality there going into preparing for a fight.
Sure. Well, first off, I'm not sure if I can say I'm a fighter yet. I don't want to sound too cocky here, put my name out there like I'm pretending I'm this huge fighter. But yes, I think it was last October or September, something around that time. I decided to start boxing. A really good friend of mine, Malin Wendel, she was starting to fight with Niklas Elfstedt. Talented guy from Sweden, here in Malta.
Also my trainer as well.
Yeah, also your trainer, yes. And so she just told me, like, you know what, I really think that you have this personality that you would love to box, fight, to do something. And I just felt that there's not too much other things going on at the moment. So let's make this my project. And I came to my first session and I just felt like, oh, this is amazing. I just get to put all this bad energy or good energy somewhere. And I felt strong. And I said very early on that I need to have a goal. I can't just come here every week and box for, maintaining my physics or thinking of bikini season next year. I want to fight if I'm gonna box with you. So that was the setup goal. And since then I've been fighting with Niklas and I was supposed to have my first fight now in March, but as you said, it got postponed. So that was a huge setback.
Yeah, can you I've been fighting as well for some time and I understand kind of the mental preparation going into the fight as well. Can you talk a little bit about, like, it's the first time, it's supposed to be your first fight now, obviously, and going into getting closer and closer to the fight, like how do you see it, like, mentally? How is your mental state as you get closer and closer? You get to know who your opponent is and all of a sudden there's a face there, and like talk a little bit about that as well.
I mean, I don't really know what I've been, if I have any concrete things that I've been thinking. I just know that I mean, being a CCO for a company or working with in an industry that is very uncertain in so many levels, there's so many changes all the time. We need to be innovative, and we never really know what we're going to wake up to the next day, right? So this thing for me was the only thing that was certain in my life, where I knew what I had to do. And I got to know myself in a different way, where I maybe reached, you know, you reach a certain level in your career when you feel confident at some certain degree. And now I had to throw myself out there again into the wild. And I never felt so scared and strong at the same time. So I think that mindset have been very helpful towards my career as well, to any new things that I need to handle at work, but also my private life. So it's been very helpful. And I think that hopefully when the fight is going to happen, it's going to be another of those adrenaline endorphin kicks, which going to leave me, okay, what's next?
Yeah, it's such a good expression that you mentioned, like you've never been so scared, but felt strong at the same time. I can absolutely relate to that as well, you know, and the feeling of like, oh my God, what the hell is going to happen here? You know, your friends are going to be there watching you. And it's not, at least for me, I don't know if it's the same for you, but at least for me, it's not so much about winning or losing. It's more about like, you don't want to make a fool out of yourself in front of your friends, you know. That at least that was what it was for me, and I just want to go out there, show that I can, because you don't really know yourself until you are put in that situation. And you know, we all have this like idea of who we are, and we all build up, we masseuse our ego, and we say, you know, I can do anything I put my mind to, and I'll never give up, and all these things. But when you are in this like extreme stressful situation of a fight, that's where you really get to know like the depth of yourself. Like, what am I really made out of in that moment? And that's where I think a lot of the fear comes from, because you don't want to like disappoint yourself in that moment, but it's very hard to know how you will react before you're there, you know? And I think that's where a lot of the insecurities come from, like leading up to a fight, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I have a perfect example of this. We had a sparring session, and I mean, it was just not my day. Like, nothing worked. The technique wasn't there. Like, I felt tired. Like, everything was just going wrong. And after, I think, the round of fourth or fifth round or something, I got so angry with myself. Like, and when I walked out of the ring, I literally had to go into the toilet and cry a bit. And this is kind of, you know, embarrassing, but I was so angry with myself. I just couldn't stop crying. And I came out and the guys were like, "Oh, you're fine. Like, you know, don't worry about it. You know, it's going to be different waves of when you feel you're on top and when you hit rock bottom, kind of." And that was just a really good lesson, because then I had to go home. I had to continue my work for the day. And then, okay, next day, let's recover and go again. So.
Yeah, exactly. And that's another thing, right? It's like, it's not like you can choose when you train. It's like, okay, today I feel great. Today I'm going to go train. And like, oh, I feel a bit tired today. I don't want to train. And that's the hardest part, I felt at least, is like when you are just completely broken down, your body, like you have to go train again and give it everything. Like mentally, it's like the most draining part, I think, this mentally reload for the sessions. And I struggle a lot to kind of maintain my work during the training camp, because my mind was like all the time trying to recover for the next session. Do you feel that as well, that it's like hard to keep the balance between, you know, you have to manage people, so you have to kind of focus on others, but at the same time you really have to focus on your own mental state during the fight?
Both yes and no. I mean, on a day-to-day basis, we are only two people here in Malta, right? So I don't have any direct contact with the team here, because they're based in India. And then Fredrik is in Stockholm. So, I mean, it is hard to keep the balance, because also, as you said, your mind is somewhere else. At least like the 2 weeks before we knew that the fight was going to get canceled. My, you know, the thoughts, everything is all over the place. And the only thing you can think of about every step you take is, yeah, working your jab or you're thinking about something else. So it's hard to keep the balance, but at the same time, that is my hobby and work is work. So you have to, at least I kind of know that.
Yeah. Yeah, it's good and impressive that you managed to keep that balance. That was something that I definitely struggled with during my last fight like 2 years ago. It's the fact that I just let the training consume me, you know, and that really affected my work. And that's also why it's hard for me to commit to another fight as well, is because I just have a hard time to keep that balance. Like, training comes first, and it's hard to do that in our positions in the end of the day. You know, you have to, I wish I could keep that balance, you know, because I love the fighting. It's amazing. But it's something maybe I can learn from you.
Yeah. Or maybe, I don't know, like how serious, I mean, I'm not going to say I'm super serious about this fight and the whole process, but obviously I'm also very good at keeping myself down and knowing that I'm humble, that this is my first fight. I'm not that amazing yet. So I don't try to hype myself up. So I don't feel like I need to train 3 times per day. I don't know how, but I think that you were pretty hardcore when you were.
Yeah, it was, I mean, I did 2 sessions per day. So Monday to Friday, 2 sessions per day, and then Saturday, 1 session. So there was 9 like hardcore sessions per week. And then it was, you know, I would say like the most interesting thing for me during that process was the fact that all these little things in life became so valuable. And so, for example, every night, you know, when I went to sleep, I mean, it was like the best feeling in the fucking world. 1-1 in swear words, by the way. I mean, it was incredible. Like, I had the best sleeps of my life, and it became like heaven to me, you know? And on the Saturday session, you know, I would have like a morning Saturday session. That was the last session of the week. And then the next session would be on the Monday morning. So that means that I have 48 hours of rest. And coming home from that Saturday session, after a long week of work, and after just this mental, like, more so than physical, it's just the mental grueling sessions, like sparring with people who are much better than you. You know, having Niklas there, who is just going to murder you every session, and just going into that mentally reloading every time is so difficult. So like, coming out of that on the Saturday, just mentally drained, and going into the sofa at home was literally the same feeling as traveling to the Bahamas or something. And, you know, the feeling when you step into the hotel and like, oh my God, this room is so nice. And you lay down on the bed and you're like, oh, this is fantastic. It's exactly the same feeling. So like, these little things in life became everything. And I learned through that, you know, doing hard things, or like working hard, pushing hard, a lot, at least for me, like a lot of the happiness that I get through my life is through doing those things. Because although I was also crying, by the way, during this time, and there was a lot of ups and downs mentally, but looking back at it now, it's one of the most valuable times of my life that I ever had. I just felt so alive for 2.5 months. You know, it's fantastic.
Something you just said, which I think that iGaming, or my career within iGaming, have helped me with, regarding that you said that it was mentally draining to spar with someone that you always felt maybe were better than you, right? So, I mean, I've been sparring with a lot of girls. Some are, you know, on a high level. Some started maybe 2 years ago, but everyone has been, you know, a few steps better than me, or hundreds. But that is something my career helped me with, that realizing that I know I don't really care about if you're better than me or not. I'm gonna see it as a learning curve, and I can distance myself from knowing my own worth comparing to if they're better or not. Because in the beginning, when I started, obviously, especially as a young woman in this industry, I always felt that everybody knew so much more than me. I was scared that I was not. If I landed a new job, how are the people going to look at me? Are they going to look at me that she deserved her spot, or she deserved to be invited to this dinner, or just because she was invited because someone invited her? do we need to test her? I always felt that I was insecure in the beginning.
Yeah.
But then after each step, that's something that I learned and gained confidence with, that, okay, I am good at what I'm doing and I am worthy of this. So regardless of how amazing you are, that's not going to affect me anymore.
Exactly. And it's such a good message in general. I think just working with people who are better than you is obviously going to elevate yourself, you know, and it's like cliche, you know, but it's very true. But you know, on that topic, Disa, you know, you're a young, you know, aspiring professional woman in this industry, and it's very male dominated, and there's a lot of testosterone in this industry. It can be seen as sexist in many, many ways. You know, coming into this industry and building your career, is this something you have been wrestling with, this kind of culture in the industry? And have you seen this changing throughout the years? You know, what's your thoughts on diversity and these type of things?
So, yes, of course, I've seen it. I mean, that was my background, and that was, I mean, even though I always felt that I was treated amazingly by all the men beside me, I mean, you can't really escape from the fact that that's what it was. I mean, it is still very men on, you know, dominated. And I know a lot of women besides me that have been treated poorly and in a different manner, even though I can't say that I always felt the same. And it has changed a lot. I mean, it's just looking at the conferences, you know, naked girls walking around, comments, and more women taking higher positions. I mean, a lot of things changed. I only have maybe 2 or 3 times when I really got pissed off. Because of the way people were treating me, because I was young and female. And I can give them as an example. And by the way, 2 of them actually apologized at a later stage, so there's no grudge whatsoever now. But I had a meeting with some people from Stockholm coming over to Malta. And when I left the room, they said some really sexist comments about me, and some of the guys actually mentioned this to me when I came back into the room. And okay. I got so angry. And so I just stood up. I said, thank you for the meeting. And I paid the bill for the restaurant. And I said, I'm going to pay now. And I'm just going to let you know that I'm going to tell the CEO of the company that I'm not going to work with you. We're not going to take you on as a client. And then I left the room. So it was kind of harsh. And the other example is that I came into the room with the CEO of the company I was working for before. And during the whole meeting, even if I was speaking, this certain person wouldn't even address me or look at me when I was speaking. He would only look at the CEO while actually I was talking. So that was something that was kind of...
Yeah, exactly. They kind
very
of...
degrading.
Yeah, exactly. They see you as not relevant or whatever, and they only speak to the CEO or something.
Yeah, like.
Yeah, you see, these are the stories that I think are really important to lift up, you know, and the discussion on diversity and equality and these type of things. I think for me, it's really important in general just kind of hear these perspectives, you know, because that's where, you know, we don't, like me as a guy in this industry, I don't have that perspective. You know, the only thing that I know is I try to do my best to not see gender in general. Like if you're a man or woman, it doesn't matter. You know, there's like bad apples in both sides, let's say.
Of course.
But lifting this perspective, because there are, like I said, the bad apples, let's say in a male dominated industry, on the male side, because it is a male dominated industry, they will naturally have more power as well, since it's a legacy male dominated industry, so it's kind of interesting to lift this topic forward. And it seems to be, you know, through, it's been years now where you know, since the Me Too movement and before that, where it's become more evident that this is not something that is just happening once in a while, once in a blue moon kind of thing. It's like almost all women have had these type of experiences, you know, in a lesser or in a higher extent. And that is, I guess, where we as men, we as guys need to, you know, understand that, and not only, you know, not only from ourselves to be aware that this is the case, but then also try to spot when others are doing something that is not correct either, and be a part of the change, you know, just like you stood up and walked off the table. You know, others have a responsibility to do the same if they see or hear something like that, right?
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. And I mean, but I think also that a lot of men, and I usually like to take the men's side on different things when we speak about this certain topic as well, because I think that a lot of men get offended when we speak about, you know, that it's a men's dominated industry and that the women have been treated poorly. A lot of men always, you know, they're on their edges when this topic comes up. And I think it's important to know or always remember that I hope that no matter what gender you are, you should always get the position you deserve. And sometimes I also believe that women have a sense, or they can intend to actually victimize themselves in a bit. And I think that it's important that men usually have a different approach when they walk into a meeting or when they apply for a job. They feel more confident, or maybe they don't feel more confident, but they portray themselves to be more confident. And maybe that's why they end up getting to position. Because as women, we already walk into the meeting feeling that we don't tick off the boxes. Maybe we don't deserve to be here. So it's on an individual level to make sure that you feel confident enough to apply for the job, or regardless of the situation. You can't always blame, you know, the men or the women for certain things. But it's good, as you said, that if you see something that is not cool, someone is saying something that they shouldn't have done, or if you hear something behind someone's back, you should be the person who stands up for these people and say, you know,
yeah,
we're such an innovative industry, we should be leading in any different questions, any different topics, right? So yeah, that we actually lack in that particular topic, or, I mean,
yeah, that's a bit poor. Yeah, exactly. And it's such a good, I think it's a great point you mentioned in general here, Disa, because there's two ways to approach diversity or true feminism, let's say this. And on one hand, you can approach it by, we need to have exactly 50-50 men and women in the organization, and we are going to make sure that we hire 50% women, 50% men, to make sure that we kind of force the equality into the organization. I think, I don't know if this is an unpopular opinion or whatever, but I don't think that's the right approach.
I agree with you.
Yeah, the other way is basically that if you are an organization and you want to have true diversity and true equality within the organization, you should instead promote that you don't look at gender, right? So if you are in a hiring process and you are considering four candidates, and two of them are men, two of them are women, try to educate your employees to see beyond gender, right?
Mm.
Yeah. What is your opinion on that in general? Like,
yeah, I mean, I would never ever just hire. Let's say that I want to have 20 people in my company. I would never hire 10 women and 10 men just because of the cost. That's not diverse to me.
Yeah.
As you just said, diversity has nothing to do with gender in that sense. For me, it's more of a competence, skills, mindset. But obviously, when it comes down to what females have experienced in the past, that is a bit of a different story, obviously. And I know that there's a very trend, it's a big trend going on now on LinkedIn, when a lot of females, different industries going out and mentioning that, you know, they don't want to be called female CEO or the female leader. They just want to be called leader. and which is, I understand the whole debate, but maybe they never, it's easy for someone to speak like that if they weren't in the same industry or haven't, you know, had the same experiences.
Exactly. I think as well, you know, when you try to force diversity, this we have to hire 50% women and 50% men, and that's the way to show ourselves as a diverse organization. To me, that's patronizing to women, because that's like implying to say that if you don't force it, it's never going to happen. It's like, to me, you have already lost that debate when you implement that strategy. It's like, yes, recognize that there is a problem in your organization. And recognize that there is a bias in your organization, but don't solve it by putting like a band-aid on the wound. You know, like solve it by like actually solving the problem. And the end goal should always be that that everyone in the organization should see diversity as something where beyond the sexes, basically. And you know, you'll have people in the organization who are never going to change. They will always have a bias, and you can force them to hire 50% men, 50% women, and you can put the band-aid on it. But the problem is still there, because the problem is that person. It's not, you know, so if you're an individual in an organization who you know, looks down on women, yeah, then maybe you shouldn't be in that organization. You know, no. What I mean? Maybe that is the issue, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think that neither of us would like to be informed afterhand, okay, so Pierre or Disa, you got this job just because we needed a man, but there was actually another female, rather man that we, you know, really wanted, but we had to pick another female, another man for this position. I mean, I would feel like, okay, thank you very much. I mean, that is the most, what a disgrace.
Yeah. Exactly, it's an insult, you know.
Yeah, how can you recover from that? Because, you know, then we were happy and believed that you were capable of something, and you got the chance, and then you just know it's just because you're a man or woman, and they need diverse in a company. I mean, it can't be like that.
No.
So that is not a solution of the problem, I would say.
Yeah, high five to that. I'm on to that.
High five.
Good. So coming to your own like leadership ethos and so forth. I mean, now you're a manager and you take care of your team in India and so on and so forth. Like, what's your leadership style and leadership ethos, and, you know, taking what you have learned and all the things, like how do you approach leadership?
So for me, leadership is, my style, I would say it's very easygoing. I intend to always make sure or ask everyone in the organization, do you need help with something? Do I have 1 minute over? Time is valuable, but that is what I can give to anyone in my team. Do we have a problem? It's not your problem, it's our problem. And just trying to be as helpful as possible, and when I can offer my expertise in some areas, I do that. Also, making sure that everybody knows that I am not an expert in every field. I want all the employees and everyone around me knowing that we help each other, and we help each other to grow, and that I'm not above them in that sense. We are equal to towards any task that we're facing.
Yeah, that's.
If that was fluffy, I don't know if that was a bit fluffy, but
no, it's a modern way of seeing leadership. I think
very modern, very flat.
So here comes the follow-up question, though: how do you think that your employees see you as a leader?
Good one. I mean, as you said before, you said I can come across as a strong, independent, cliche woman. I don't see myself in that, in the same way. Maybe they look at me, and I don't know if some of them are a bit, I wouldn't say scared of me, but maybe I come across to be a bit more rough than I am. But in general, I really believe that they think that I'm a down to earth and a very modern leader.
Yeah,
I hope so. I'm gonna ask them.
Yes, yeah, do. You know,
I need to.
It's a healthy conversation to have with your employees. I think just to have that dialogue. And you know, when I asked the question, I realized that I don't ask my employees that question either. Actually, I would love to ask them as well. Actually, just to understand kind of where you can improve as well. What do you do well? What do you don't do well? And these type of things are important conversation to have. I think and. You know, maybe not many managers dare to ask that question to them, please.
I don't know. I think it's different levels. I mean, if you're, I don't know, CEO of a company, you have other people that handle different, you know, other sections and departments on a company. But as a manager, I think that, I mean, it's big corporate companies usually have these quarterly meetings, right? Maybe once per month, quarterly, once per year. So, yeah, I really need to do that.
Yeah.
Now I'm going to be stressed, like, oh.
Yeah, exactly. Let's do it, both of us, and we'll have to follow up with the results from this conversation and see what we learned.
Yes, that would be really interesting.
Maybe they're like, Pierre, sorry, but this is not
this is not working out. Yeah. I don't think so.
I hope not.
I think you're probably a sweet guy.
I don't know. Yeah, to be honest with you, I mean, we have open conversation today, and I enjoy this a lot actually. And I'll tell you an insecurity of mine actually. I'll say that my biggest insecurity is probably my management skills. I think.
Yeah, I
don't see myself as a good leader because I'm very task oriented.
Okay.
I'm not so people oriented in my leadership style. Like when we have these conversations. I'm very much into you as a person or whoever I speak to or social and these things. But in my work life, I feel very different. Like I feel very task oriented. And sometimes I live in the future in my mind. So I tend to forget what my employees' concerns are right now. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's, I think, something that I need to improve, I think.
But in your organization, so I know, do you and... So what is the division like? Do you and Martin have different, do you deal more with the other employees and Martin, or like how is your structure in the company?
I'm the MD, so I have ultimate responsibility for everything that happens in the organization. But we create a structure now where basically Garda, who is our head of operations, she has management responsibility of most of the staff in the organization, and also new starters that come in. She will have management responsibility. I used to have much more management responsibility because the organization was much flatter, so I would manage pretty much all staff. And that I realized is not what is good for me, or what is good for them, or what is good for the company. Because again, I'm much more business development oriented. My mind is elsewhere, you know. It's something I'd like to become a lot better at as we go forward, especially when the organization grows. It's like I'm supposed to be the leader of the organization. So I need to always be able to kind of have a good understanding of how the employees are doing on an individual basis. Yeah, that's something I need to improve.
But according to me, now, thank you for mentioning it. And you just said something that is, I would say it is, for me at least, number one on my list, what defines good leadership or management is recognizing your own flaws. And by you saying that, okay, so maybe you're more task-oriented or maybe not always checking in on their needs, but you also then give the responsibility on some areas to someone else. So that is also looking after your employees, right? You're knowing what's best for you, you're knowing what's best for the organization, and you're by then know what's best for them. So that is a very important skill.
No? Thank you for turning this something positive, Disa. Yeah. Yes, I'll take that with me. I would actually say that would be my strength as a manager. The fact that I recognize that I'm not always the most hands-on manager, so I leave that responsibility to someone else.
Interested around again.
Yeah. No, but I mean it. It is something I think I agree with you in general that not having the ego. To get into the way of how the situation actually is super important skill. I mean, there are so many shitty managers who blames their employees for being shitty employees when in reality they are the shitty manager. You know what I mean? And the fact that you're able to recognize your own weaknesses is just an absolutely pivotal skill and kind of surpass your ego in some way. And they think so. Absolutely, that is something important. And I don't know if you worked under bad management part of your career, but you know, it rips the soul out of you. You know.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, it can really destroy your employees. It's if you're a manager or in any kind of working in a big organization where you need to lead people towards a different directions and you're going to manage a team, you need to first of recognize who are these people in my team? Like what differences are there between them and what skills do they have? And I think that bad management, which maybe both of you and I have experienced in the past, we had managers who let maybe everybody follow the same path and not weren't able to help them individually to grow. Let's say that you're more task oriented or more data driven than I am, but I'm amazing at the conferences or more social than you are. We should not face the same task or the same kind of treatment. That's what I think. So good management will pick that up and let the great different employees do what they're actually best at. And that would also lead the organization to be flourishing when everybody feel comfortable and knowing that they're actually valued for just their great skills.
Yeah, I think that's a great way of defining it, actually. It's an interesting way of defining it. It's a never ending story, I guess, to like keep improving and learning from your mistakes and so on and so forth. I think, although I say like I have bad confidence being a leader, especially a couple of years ago, I think where I just wasn't there enough for my employees and too much like micromanagement and these other things. But I hope that I can improve on that front. And I think going forward, that is something that is like a big thing for me that I want to actually get to a point where I can be an inspiring leader rather than just someone who doesn't think enough about the stuff. So yeah, let's see. Maybe we'll do this podcast in a couple of years again, and we can follow up and see where we are then.
And I'm pretty sure when the people in your team gonna watch this, they're probably gonna come and give you a big hug and tell you, you know what, you're so wrong.
Well, this is a great test now, Disa, to see if anyone does that, because then I know that they have actually watched the podcast. So exactly. Yeah. So if you're watching, you know what you need to do.
Yeah, you need to tell Pierre, he's amazing. Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah. A lot subject today as well, Disa. It's amazing how time flies when you're having a good time. And we're already an hour into this podcast, actually, but we have another subject that I'd love to talk about today as well, that I actually wanted to start with today, but we got into such an interesting conversation and that we just had to let it flow, which is gambling addiction.
Yes.
And you have obviously personal experience with gambling addiction, not you yourself, but the people that are close to you. So I want to just start, you know, you have quite a unique experience with this, and working in the gaming industry, we are somewhat exposed to it in the sense that we know it's there. And I think that there's a lot of stories that you hear, you know, problematic gamblers going into customer support with like really horrendous stories, and you see it on the news and so on and so forth. But you have actually experienced this yourself. Like how has this helped shape your view of the industry? And can you talk a little bit more about your experience?
Yeah, sure. So as you said, I don't think that people really realize how bad it can be and why people, you know, log into the different support systems and leaving horrible comments about our industry, because they have a completely different side of our industry than we do. And I mean, I hated iGaming. I hated casino before I actually started to work for Evolution Gaming. I'm still kind of terrorized by some of certain memories. So someone in my, you know, close surrounding used to play a lot of poker. That's how it all started. It was a lot of poker during the poker boom, when it was, you know, everybody was playing poker. And it was a lot of money going back and forth, and I never really thought about it too much because it wasn't really a big thing or big deal by then until we lived under the same roof. And it got so bad at some certain points where, you know, what the person would sneak away to gamble, not coming home during the nights, been at the casinos, gambling, could be 1 month, you know, can you pay the rent because I have nothing on my account? Like all these last minute resorts where probably the person tried to maybe lost a lot of money and then needed to borrow money to, you know, get back plus minus again. And yeah, it got really bad at some point. So I didn't like the people who worked in iGaming. I didn't understand their moral, and I didn't understand how there could not be any kind of safety net around gambling. So when I started Evolution Gaming, I felt like a hypocrite because I felt like I was contributing to an industry which I was not supporting. But then after a while, I also realized that if you at least can try to be part of a solution, then you're trying to do something about the problem. There's going to be so many different addictions. I mean, we can always compare it to alcohol. We can compare it to drugs, prostitution, gambling, and all these taboo topics or things that in our society, which is very negative, reflected. But if you can be part of that and actually hands on trying to help someone, even from the other side, or try to understand what they're going through and try to understand if you can do something, I think that's a great... then they're going to be great bridge between the two.
What an amazing way to see this issue, you know, because it's something many people in this industry wrestle with, the fact that, you know, friends and family are asking them, why do you work in this industry? And I think that most people in the industry actually try to forget about the problem sometimes. And they don't want to think about the dark side of the industry, so to say. But what you are saying here is that, you know, you realize that rather than just pretending that the industry doesn't exist, let's say, mm-hmm. that if you can be a part of the industry and to take part in this industry and driving it from something that is negative to be an actual change in the industry, you can be a part of making sure that you are a part of a force that are avoiding similar things to happen to others, you know. And if you want to make real change in this world, sometimes you have to look at where the problems are and what the in this case potentially a negative industry, and trying to work from there.
I mean, and you will never win unless you just go at an industry, let's say, you know, people have a very negative idea of iGaming, and I understand that in a certain degree. But if you just leave bad comments in customer support saying, you know, I hate you and yada yada, whatever it's going to be, you're never going to solve something because it's just going to get deleted. It's going to be nothing. So even just by having this podcast, your podcast, my podcast, even though it's a lot of iGaming people that probably watching it, I hope that it's going to reach a different crowd as well. At least my episodes when I'm doing Casino by Her, is that I want anyone to be able to go in and kind of see the people behind or who's working within our industry and learn about different positions, what we're doing, and realize we're not that bad. And there are so many people that are trying to make iGaming a better experience and entertainment for the player, but also looking after their safety. We're trying to build the safety net with the regulations. In Sweden, we have Spelstopp. There's a lot of few things that we have implemented over the years to show and to gain trust again from the players, that we're actually trying to help them so they're not going to end up in a situation where it's gone too far.
And the way I see it as well is that there's a clear divide between kind of the old cowboy generation, if you want to call it, in the iGaming industry, and the newer generation, which is much more focused on sustainability and making sure that the industry is heading to a place where it doesn't cause harm to society, right? Mm-hmm. And just look at Kindred now, who have publicly stated that they are going to aim to eliminate harmful gambling completely from the organization. Then, you know, you can discuss if that's realistic or whatever, but that force can only come from within the organizations, from employees who genuinely want to bring the industry into a better position. And they, you know, more and more of the younger, especially employees, are demanding that the organizations are taking responsibility. You know, coming into an industry with that type of mindset that, you know, you want to solve these very like serious issues is an absolute key to avoid like similar situations that would happen to the person in your life from ever happening again, you know. So I think that you have an absolutely like inspirational view on this, coming from the background that you have, rather than looking at the industry with resentment. And you know, you'll never be able to shut this industry down, you know. So you might as well try to go into it to make it better. So all the kudos to you for, you know, being able to reason in this way, you know.
Thank you a lot. And yeah. An example, I mean, I used to work as a bartender many years ago. And if you had a customer coming in, or anyone at the nightclub that you were serving, and you felt like, okay, it's my responsibility to make sure that this person does not drink. The person can't order one more cocktail because I feel that they're too intoxicated. I could stop them, right? What we didn't have before in iGaming or online casino, someone can actually reach out. I know a lot of companies had this policy, that unless the player actually said, like straight out, like I have a gambling addiction, they were not entitled to close the account, even for like a shorter period of time. And I think that is horrible, obviously, because for someone with an addiction to actually commit or like say that, hi, I have an addiction, yeah, that is very hard. So even though everybody knew by these comments, you know, they said, I can't pay my rent, I'm not going to have food or money for food by the end of the day. I mean, that is kind of very dark comments for someone to leave without saying that I have a really, really bad problem.
Absolutely.
So now, I mean, that's changed now. So on the positive side, our industry is really becoming so much better. And hopefully we will end up in a few years where people in society have gained more trust for us again. Because we are amazing people in this industry, and we really do good, and we do contribute back to the societies. So, yeah.
Exactly. And so a final question today would be on just that subject. You know, the past is the past, and you know, we've learned a lot through that, and we clearly, the industry is heading towards a much brighter future when it comes to sustainability. There's a consensus in the industry, even amongst the biggest players, especially amongst the biggest organization, that we have to solve player protection. And this is something that there's going in a lot of investment into. There is a lot that is happening on that front that maybe the general person on the street doesn't know about. Serious AML, anti-money laundering checks, KYC, and also AI tools being implemented to be able to predict addictive behavior before it happens. And What would you say, Disa, as a final thing today, are we at a point now in the industry where we are taking full responsibility? Or what would you say is like, from a legislative point of view, how should the industry be regulated? Do you think Sweden is getting right with deposit limits, for example? Is there more that can be done? What do you think?
I mean, I think we're on the right track. It's a very tough question, right? And I don't really think that we've come up to with a final great solution for everyone involved. I do believe it's great that that you can actually, you know, disconnect and you're not going to get bombarded. Let's say that we are more unified. If I want to close my account at one casino, I don't want to get 10,000 other emails from other operators. So this is what we, during the regulation in Sweden, at least what we have been able to kind of work through, is that you have that safety net, which we didn't have before. So that's one good thing. I am not really sure. I think that for me, without having a concrete answer to your question right now, exactly what we can do or what I believe gonna happen in the future, is that the more the more open we are fronting the companies, the less we hide, the more trust we're gonna gain. Like with everything online now, everything is online, and we're building personas around affiliate websites. We're building personas on YouTube. We're fronting ourselves. We're speaking up, and we're meeting questions, etc. I think that is very key for our industry if we want to be sustainable, that we actually open up and invite the other side.
Absolutely. What a great way to end the podcast today. What do you say, Disa?
I think so too. I hope so, at least.
Yeah, I think so as well. This has been an absolute pleasure to have you on today, Disa. Like I said, I'm happy to know you. I'm happy to be a friend. You're an amazing person. And you have an absolutely incredible future ahead of you. And, you know, thank you as well. I mean, you're an inspiration to me as well. And I learned a lot just from doing this podcast. So, again, thank you so much for today. And any closing thoughts from your end?
No, I just wanted to say thank you as well. I think that you're way too humble. And I am very proud of your podcast. I'm very proud of where your journey so far, and I can't wait to see what holds the future for you too. And I'm happy to call you my friend as well, now we finally got to speak more, and you're very intelligent, and it's amazing me if people see that, you know, that you put yourself out there. You should keep doing that. And believe in yourself.
I know. Let's definitely talk. Let's continue the discussion. And hopefully I'll see you on the beach soon with the training sessions with Niklas as well.
Yes.
That'll be the next time, I think. Yeah, I hope so too. Well, thank you so much for today, Disa. And also thanks to the sponsors, Pragmatic Solutions, Kalamba Games, and to everyone else, happy Easter to you, Disa. Happy Easter. Beautiful eggs behind you as well that you have painted. I mean, makes me feel like, you know, getting some chocolate eggs or something. But yeah.
Should have painted one for you.
Yes.
Happy Easter.
Happy Easter. Thank you all so much. Okay. Take care
Thank
and
you.
Stay safe.
Stay safe.